from the Broadcast Center in Medicine Hat. This is the Chat Evening News.
Tonight, spared closure.
It's a key piece of the healthcare picture in southern Alberta.
What is the future of rural hospitals in Alberta? And violence awareness. Adults are sharing messages with teens about consent and respectful relationships.
Plus in sports, the Calgary Flames begin life without their captain.
Good evening, I'm Dan Reynish. Two breaking news stories as we come to air tonight. Police are on the hunt this hour for an armed man in the city's south end. The man is believed to be a suspect in several robberies in the area. Officers tracked him to a home on Porter Place around 2:30 this afternoon. Several streets in the area were blocked off and fire crews were brought in with infrared cameras to assist in the search. Students at nearby Southview School were placed in a hold and secure while parents were given instructions about picking up their children. The area is now open. The public can resume regular activities. The man is now at large and the major crimes unit is now on the case.
At this point, part of our investigation will require a forensic analysis of the scene, so our forensics team will be working in there and documenting the crime scene. And we're also talking to neighbors and witnesses in the neighborhood.
The suspect is described as a male between the ages of 20 and 30 years old. He was wearing black shorts, black leggings, a green shirt, and a dark-colored hoodie. Police say the man should be considered armed and dangerous. If you spot him, you are asked not to approach this man. Call 911. The other breaking story we have for you is 500 full-time staff at Aurora Cannabis are being laid off. The layoffs are part of a business transformation plan that was announced today. 25% of the jobs being eliminated are corporate positions. According to a release, the company has undertaken a detailed account of all capital projects underway. Decisions have been made whether to continue or terminate further investment. In November, Aurora announced it was deferring the majority of final construction of its facility here in Medicine Hat. At that time, the company expected to have at least 6 flower rooms completed and operating sometime this year. A hospital for Southeast Alberta. The Bow Island Healthcare Center has been spared closure this week following an AHS performance review. Chantel Wagner has more on the recommendations for rural hospitals in our province.
The Bow Island Healthcare Center is one of the 83 smaller hospitals in the province. It was part of the provincial government's review of Alberta Health Services. The hospital has been spared from closure, but the town's mayor worries these smaller healthcare facilities are seen as low-hanging fruit.
In our case, it's not just Bow Island. It's the county of 40 Mile. It's there's patients come here from Cypress County and Newell to the north of us, and it's a key piece of the healthcare picture in southern Alberta.
While it may have been spared from closure, the mayor believes changes will be made when it comes to service provided.
A lot of the talk in the report was around the emergency departments, and how they're not always really busy late at night and that sort of thing. What's going to happen there?
According to the report, 77 emergency departments meet the criteria to be closed or reclassified. The report does not list specific locations, but notes many emergency rooms average 3 patients per night between 11 p.m. and 7 a.m. Because of this, the report suggests reduced operating hours could be more suitable. But the NDP worries about the impact this could have on seniors living in rural areas.
Many rural seniors who need emergency care will have to be taken away from their community, putting greater stress on them and their families and reducing their chances of recovery.
For residents in Bow Island, they feel strongly about their hospital and services it provides.
It's part of our community, keeps our little town going. We even notice that there's a lot of the hat that comes out because of the lineups there. So it's extremely important. It's overwhelmed usually.
You gotta have that. Too far to go to these other hospitals.
Very important. We have very good health care as far as I'm concerned.
AHS has 100 days to come up with a plan from this report, and we won't know how it would impact hospital services. But in the meantime, it's business as usual at the Bow Island Health Center. Chantel Wagner, Chat News.
The February is Teen Dating Violence Awareness Month, and the Medicine Hat Women's Shelter is trying to show teens in our city the importance of healthy relationships and where you can turn to for help if needed. The shelter has partnered with the library to conduct presentations about healthy relationships through the month. Today at Alexandra Middle School, students were able to make their own buttons. The buttons have messages about consent and respectful relationships. Representatives from the Women's Shelter and the Public School Division say it's important to teach teens about proper dating behavior starting in junior high.
As they get older into the teens, they're starting to date and find their significant others. So knowing what is a good coping strategy in a relationship and what is a bad one is also really important.
We want to start good behavior young. We want to start talking about what is normal, what is healthy, what is unhealthy, what is abuse. And when you start dating, how should you be acting? How should you be treating another person with respect and your partner? And, you know, if things are going bad, where can you go to for help?
The shelter says healthy relationships include partners respecting and supporting each other. They add controlling behavior in a relationship, including isolation from friends, is a sign of abuse. Moisture levels across southeastern Alberta are at average levels right now, but the provincial forecast is predicting an above normal runoff from the mountains. Mountain runoffs from both the Old Man Basin and Bow River Basin are expected to be above to well above average due to snow accumulations. However, Alberta Environment warns its forecast is based on rainfall averages that usually come throughout the spring. Soil moisture levels across southeastern Alberta are in the normal range for this time of year right now, but precipitation is slightly below average over the past year. Was a bit of a windy one out there today, but still gorgeous. Standing by my colleague Desiree's reception desk today, looking into the outside, I wished I could get out of here for a couple minutes. But a busy day leads to a full newscast for you and lots of weather to talk about when we come back with the AccuWeather forecast. Right now it's zero. The winds from the northwest at 17 kilometers an hour. Slight chances of snow tonight, and snow is what we'll focus on once we have just finished looking at the water levels. Yeah, we'll look at snow when we get back with the AccuWeather forecast in a few minutes. Straight ahead, a new report indicates just how much the federal carbon tax will cost farmers. The provincial crown has filed an appeal of a Medicine Hat judge's decision to discharge murder allegations at a preliminary hearing. The case involves second-degree murder charges against 37-year-old Chase Leland Hare, who was arrested in January 2019. Hare was alleged to have killed his partner June Rose at the pair's Bosano residence. A preliminary hearing at Medicine Hat Provincial Court last month saw the allegations discharged due to lack of evidence. The Crown is now appealing to the Court of Queen's Bench. A hearing is expected to be held in April. Alert Medicine Hat's organized crime team, together with Medicine Hat Police Service, arrested three people on Tuesday after a planned traffic stop. Alert believes the suspects were transporting meth into the city, valued at $15,000. 29-year-old Olivia Marshall and 33-year-old Patrick Brill are both from Medicine Hat, and 28-year-old Travis Lang of Redcliffe. They have all been charged with possession of drugs for the purpose of trafficking. A new report out of Saskatchewan indicates how much the federal carbon tax will actually cost farmers. And as Tom Vernon explains, producers here in Western Canada are now pushing back against the tax in Ottawa.
For farmers, there are costs that simply can't be avoided, from getting their products to market to heating barns and, in wet years, drying grain. These all require fossil fuels and are now subject to the federal carbon tax. A report released this week out of Saskatchewan has crunched the numbers.
That can have the impact of reducing your farm income from by 8% this year and by as much as 12.5% in 2022.
Dwayne Hovey says that is an expense that can't be passed along to consumers because farmers don't set the prices for their products. A group of Western Canadian farmers have gone to Parliament Hill to raise their concerns.
The carbon tax on our farm has a really detrimental impact on our bottom line.
William Pallister farms in Manitoba. He says farmers are already doing their part for the environment, and the carbon tax won't help them improve.
If we don't have that money, we can't invest in that technology, which is green, which helps our farm be more environmentally sustainable.
The issue came up during question period. The Conservatives are demanding that farms be fully exempt.
Will the Prime Minister please finally acknowledge that his carbon tax is unfairly punishing agriculture producers?
The price on pollution both cuts pollution and puts money back into the pockets absolutely. Of families in Alberta, in Saskatchewan, right across the country.
The government says there are financial supports available for farmers to make energy efficiency investments and that they're working on more practical solutions. We've committed to doing an early review focused on competitiveness issues in trade-exposed industries such as agriculture, spokesperson Moira Kelly said in a statement. Dwayne Halvey says current supports like the rebate fall well short, and as the carbon tax goes up, it will only hit farmers harder.
If you're comparing, you know, $15,000 that you're paying out and a $500 credit on the other side, it doesn't really make up for it.
Tom Vernon, Global News.
Thank you for choosing Chat for your news tonight. There's much more still to come. Mitch will be here with sports and details about which Canadian basketball star got traded at the NBA trade deadline today. The AccuWeather forecast does have some snow in it. We'll also have the latest on this story coming up as well. Coming up, for the second time in as many months, a train has derailed southeast of Saskatoon. For the second time in as many months, a train has derailed southeast of Saskatoon. A CP train carrying oil went off the tracks early this morning, causing a massive explosion and forcing the evacuation of a nearby town. Here's Ryan Kessler with more.
This is the view from a farmyard in central Saskatchewan, burning twisted metal, the sight and sound interrupting an otherwise quiet place.
This is a fairly rural, less populated area, but why this could happen in any of the larger centers down the line.
Canadian Pacific says its train derailed just after 6 a.m. Thursday. Tankers carrying crude oil caught fire, the smoke so dark and thick. For people in these parts, it's happened twice in 2 months, 10 kilometers apart.
They're getting more concerned every day, like why is this happening and why here? Obviously we need to take a close look at what's going on, and it needs to be dissected and people need to be made aware of the situation.
In early December, more than 30 CP oil tanker cars left the tracks, releasing 1.5 million liters of oil into the environment. Now roughly 85 people who were evacuated are waiting for answers on the latest oil fuel derailment.
There has been no communication. The only reason I know anything is because I took the initiative to call CP. Because I'm displaced. I have two big dogs. I have three kids that are in school right now. I have a wife and a father-in-law.
According to the Saskatchewan Public Safety Agency, no one was hurt when 31 cars derailed.
We have a crude oil on fire. Ministry of Environment is on scene and will be working with other authorities along with CP Rail to do the cleanup over after the fire is suppressed.
Extinguishing the fire is the first step, though the provincial agency says the smoke does pose a risk to both residents and firefighters. A team from the Transportation Safety Board has also been sent to investigate at the site. Ryan Kessler, Global News.
A judge in Calgary has ruled in connection with the ongoing labor dispute between Co-op Refinery and its union members. Picketers will still be able to strike, but the blockade they've created preventing fuel from being delivered to Co-op trucks will have to come down. The picket line at the Carseland Terminal was set up 2 weeks ago in support of Co-op Refinery workers who were locked out after they voted to strike in December. Federated Co-op says the blockade isn't just affecting the company, but it's also causing issues for customers. This morning, Judge Glenda Campbell ruled that the blockade was unlawful, saying the picketers created a threatening and intimidating environment for those looking to enter the terminal. The judge says picketers are still allowed to be present at the fuel terminal at least 5 meters from the terminal property. They can't block access or interfere with anyone looking to enter or leave, and the pickets must also take down fences that have been put up around the terminal. Alberta health officials giving another coronavirus update today. There are still no cases in our province, but health officials are taking new steps to potentially protect the public. The province says it is acting out of an abundance of caution. Officials say the risk in Alberta is still low, but anyone who has visited Hubei province in the past 14 days is now being asked to stay home and self-isolate for 2 weeks since the last day in Hubei province. While in isolation, monitor for symptoms and call HealthLink if you feel sick.
Self-isolation means staying home and away from others. It means avoiding work, school, social events, or other public gatherings where it is likely that there would be close contact with other people. We expect only a very small group of Albertans will need to isolate themselves, given the restricted travel measures currently in China.
Two planes carrying Canadians are finally on their way from Wuhan, China. Just under 200 Canadians, including children, are on board. One plane is chartered by the Canadian government. The second is an American plane that had some spare seats and offered them to Canada. As Michael Couture reports, they still have to go through rigorous screening before they can get home.
According to government officials, there were a number of no-shows at the airport for the first flight, but more than 200 Canadians are now on their way back home. Here's the scene earlier Thursday at the Wuhan airport as passengers arrived to get on that Canadian charter. There had been concern about families being separated because one may hold permanent resident status and not have Canadian citizenship.
Please don't split up families.
Megan Millward, who was in that very situation, got some good news. She says that her husband did make it on the flight and won't be left behind.
The plane just got here.
Other passengers are telling us the entire process at the airport was very well organized, with Chinese officials conducting thermal scans of all people before they got on the plane. And those people will be monitored by Canadian officials throughout the flight home to make sure that if anyone shows symptoms of the coronavirus, they'll be isolated from others. A couple of passengers told us how excited they were to finally see the plane there in front of them, because it was a clear sign they were finally heading out of China.
We were expecting it to be a long journey, so I think we are prepared for what's coming our way. But the fact that the plane has landed, it's right in front of us, I think it's pretty reassuring that we'll be able to get to go home.
While that plane and the American one make their way back, the Foreign Affairs Minister has already announced a second Canadian charter will be going to repatriate Canadians from China. François-Philippe Champagne said it will leave Wuhan on February 10th and arrive back in Canada the following day. And those people will also be put in quarantine. However, it's unclear if they'll be sent to CFB Trenton in Ontario or another military base. Michael Couture, Global News, Ottawa.
Meanwhile, two Canadians and one American are among the 10 people who have tested positive while they were on an overseas cruise. Hundreds of fellow Canadians remain quarantined on the ship, confined to their cabins. Jordan Armstrong has more.
No one's at the pool. Instead, every single passenger aboard the Diamond Princess is confined to his or her cabin, including Spencer Fehrenbacher of Fort Langley.
Hello, everyone. This is Spencer. I am coming to you from Yokohama, Japan, on board the Diamond Princess.
The ship, with more than 2,600 passengers, now anchored after a 14-day round-trip cruise. 20 of its passengers, including two Canadians, have tested positive for coronavirus and taken off the ship for treatment. The rest, like Fehrenbacher, will remain under quarantine on the ship for at least 14 days.
We are currently in the middle of day two of a 14-day-long quarantine, and we're now trying to spend our time reading, watching television, and just trying to stay generally positive.
Meals are delivered to his cabin three times a day, wrapped in foil and served by crew members wearing protective suits. The federal government says there's little it can do for the Canadians.
We will look at the cruise line in this case to repatriate those Canadians when the quarantine, which has been decided by local health authority, is finished.
A similar situation in Hong Kong, where 30 passengers on this ship have a fever. All 1,800 are being tested.
At the time being, I think we cannot conclude the likely time of finishing the quarantine measures right now.
Back in Japan, Fehrenbacher says the hardest part is not knowing whether his virus sample has been tested yet.
I will keep you updated with information as it becomes available.
For now, the 29-year-old and his three companions feel lucky to have a balcony, because many others aboard the ship have no view of the outside world. Jordan Armstrong, Global News.
Anger tonight after the RCMP carried out a pre-dawn raid on an indigenous camp in northern BC, where protesters have been blocking the construction of the Coastal GasLink pipeline. The police convoy rolled in at around 3 a.m. Armed officers arrested six people at kilometer 39, one of three camps built by anti-pipeline supporters. The RCMP is enforcing a Supreme Court injunction that requires workers are given access to the area after talks to find a peaceful solution between the hereditary chiefs and the BC government broke down.
Financial Markets brought to you by Neil Mardian and Matt Solberg at TD Wealth, helping families make their wealth dreams a reality.
Here's how the markets closed today. The dollar was down 0.01% to 75.24 cents U.S. The TSX up 105.90 basis points to 17,757.49. While the Dow Jones was up 88.92 basis points to 29,379.77. Gold up $7.20 to $1,570 U.S. an ounce. Natural gas up a penny to $1.86 U.S. per MMBTU. And oil up 20 cents to $50.95 U.S. a barrel. Well, that's how you tell it apart. Oh, we're talking numbers here. Mitch Bach, myself, talking numbers. So I grew up in Europe. So when I do a 7, because the European one is just an up and down.
Right.
So you put a line through the 7 so you know it's not a 1.
If it's a line,
has to be the right
and
way.
And then a line vertically through it, it's a T.
It can be a T.
I'm learning things.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah,
I'm also teaching.
But then again, a B is two S's. So, I mean, you know, there's...
A B is two S's.
A B, an upwards B that looks like a euro sign is two S's in German. So much to learn when it comes to languages.
We're in Canada.
Yeah, you won't need to do that. Yeah. You won't need to do that. One thing we need to do, though, is we need to tell people what's going on this weekend.
Yeah, and the man to do that has been doing it for a long time now. Here's Mike LaCour.
Mike LaCour.
Good evening, gents. Here is what is up for the weekend. The annual Snowflake Soiree is on Saturday at the Beverage Building. From 6 p.m. to midnight, you get to enjoy cocktails, dinner, and a silent auction through the evening. Comedian Dave Nystrom will be the evening's entertainment. Proceeds go to support the CMHA. Get tickets at eventbrite.ca. The 2020 Valentine's Gala is in Vauxhall on Saturday, starting at 5 p.m. at the Vauxhall Community Hall. Tickets are $55 each or $400 for a table of 8. Enjoy a silent auction, dinner, and dance. Proceeds are for the St. Joseph's Parish Building Fund. Text 403-795-3351 for tickets. And the Community Foundation of Southeastern Alberta will be hosting a series of their Vital Conversations. One of them is on Monday from 6:30 to 8 p.m. at Hell's Basement Brewery. The conversation is geared to those aged 18 to 29. RSVP to the event at admin@cfsea.ca. Get more on what's happening this weekend by checking out the events calendar at chatnewstoday.ca. And if there's an event you'd like us to feature on What's Up, email us at chatnews@jpbg.ca. Back to you guys.
Now, I know that you are a pretty big Raiders fan.
Me?
Yeah.
PA Raiders.
Yes.
Not LA Raiders. The next home of Tom Brady,
right,
apparently.
As in the Raiders who were in town last night.
Yes. You don't hate me because of how that game ended up, do you?
You know, you don't hate the Tigers because they took 7 of a possible 8 points.
No, I would never hate the Tigers. They're my local team. The Raiders are my favorite team. They were my father's team, so I love them.
Well,
but was the
honesty hour?
Was it a great game? I mean, you know,
it was a tough game for both teams. Both teams locked down defensively. Great game. That's for sure.
Did you think heading into the final few minutes that the Tigers had that game locked up?
I did. Yes, I was calling up Colton McKee, our camera guy, about post game interviews and stuff like that. Like, hey, yeah, so it's gonna go this way. So maybe I'm the guy who jinxed the game last night.
I'm not saying jinx to Mitch. I would never say any of that sort of stuff. But what you were experiencing last night was the Prince Albert surprise.
Is that what that is?
That's what I called it.
Yeah. Well, Tigers and Prince Albert. Tigers have more points than Prince
they
Albert.
They do. They do. Tigers having a better season.
Yeah.
But the Raiders are defending champions.
True. Okay.
Hang that one on
the
shelf.
It's in the past. It's in the past.
No, that's true.
Well, I'll have more on the game here in a little bit. Let's start in Calgary, okay?
Yes, please do,
It is not a best case scenario for the Calgary Flames, but it was a bullet dodged for Mark Giordano. The Flames captain has avoided a major injury, not needing surgery. However, he has been placed on the IR listed week to week. General Manager Brad Treleving says he feared the worst after his best blue liner limped off the ice on Tuesday.
The good news is this is not as long-term as we initially feared. No surgical procedure, nothing of that nature, and it's just going to be, we'll get through this next week, which will be the first week off, and then just monitor it.
I could feel definitely that it was overstretched, and there was something wrong. I felt kind of wobbly when I got up, too, so knew something was up, but a lot of thoughts go through your mind when that happens, but just I got to get through. Now I got to get through the rehab. I'm gonna do everything I can. I'm gonna get it treated a lot. I'm gonna work out hard, and hopefully I can get back quick here.
So Calgary hosts Nashville tonight. The Predators sitting 3 points back of Calgary for the second wildcard spots in the West. It's a busy night for Canadian teams. A couple of games already underway. Montreal holding a 1-0 lead over Anaheim, while the Avalanche also 1-0 over the Ottawa Senators. Just about to drop the puck, two games. Winnipeg is in St. Louis and Vancouver is in Minnesota. And later on tonight at 7:30, the Oilers hosting the same San Jose Sharks who beat Calgary two nights ago. Well, I'd have loved to be a fly on the wall of the Tigers dressing room after the game last night, except odds are it wouldn't have been a very pretty sight. The Crew allowing the Raiders to tie it up with just 7 seconds left, and then in overtime,
Tigers get possession and setting it up. Here's Watts setting it up. Here's a shot. They score. The Prince Albert Raiders.
Alexei Protas tallied not only the game-tying marker, but also the winner in overtime. Two goals just 15 seconds apart to steal the victory away. Medicine had also relinquished three scoring opportunities on the empty net. Despite earning a single point, they're now two back of Lethbridge for home ice advantage in the opening round, and they're trying to use it as a learning lesson.
You cannot recover in the playoffs from these. It's so hard to get up the next day and recover from this, so we got to learn from that. It's better to happen in February than in March and April.
We're up late there. They come down, they get one there. It happens, but to get 7 out of 8 points against these guys in the season, it's unbelievable.
We just want to kind of take a look at the breakdowns that we had, but I mean, we're going in another 4-point weekend here, so we know we got two good games ahead of us that we got to be prepared for.
Well, it's looking more and more like a Highway 3 opening round. However, the Tigers still have 18 games to play, and a lot could change by then. Edmonton is comfortably on top of the Central Division. Calgary holds the first wildcard spot in the conference, while Red Deer and Swift Current are both well back of playoff spots. Well, it is trade deadline day in the NBA, and the biggest deal involves one of the best Canadians in the league. Andrew Wiggins is leaving the Minnesota Timberwolves and will begin a new chapter with the Golden State Warriors. Now, this is according to a source familiar with the situation. The cost for Wiggins is D'Angelo Russell, another bona fide scorer in the league who is now linking arms with his friend Carl Anthony Towns in Minnesota. Wiggins, a product of Thornhill, Ontario, was drafted first overall in 2014, but hasn't lived up to the highly touted hype built around him. He's currently in his second season of a 5-year, $147 million contract. Meanwhile, it didn't take Matt Nichols long to find a new home. TSN is reporting the former Blue Bombers pivot has agreed to a 3-year deal with the Toronto Argonauts. This comes 3 days after the Argos re-signed quarterback McLeod Bethel-Thompson to an extension. Nichols spent 5 seasons in Winnipeg, but the Bombers opted to re-sign Zach Collaros and allowed Nichols to leave the team ahead of free agency. The Californian was limited to just 9 starts last year after going under the knife on a shoulder injury last summer. All right, and that's all the time I have for sports. Stay tuned. The Toronto Raptors made history last night. Find out more details on that. Plus, the McCoy Colts are tearing it up this season. Find out just how good they are when we come back.
Still to come, parents are concerned about the amount of hours teenagers are wasting playing video games. Thousands of people with type 1 diabetes around the world are hacking into their insulin pumps with instructions they found online, and they say it's giving them a better quality of life. Here's Sulin Go with this health story.
So this is the app I've built.
Okay. Yeah.
This is the loop.
Jonathan Garfinkel has no background in science or computers, yet he's showing diabetes researchers how he made his own technology to control his blood sugar levels.
So you don't need to make those adjustments, it's automatically doing it.
Yeah.
Jonathan is among thousands of people with type 1 diabetes who are hacking into their insulin pumps with instructions they found online.
I mean, the first 24 hours were like, oh my God, I can't believe what I've done.
The loop requires a continuous glucose monitor, an old hackable insulin pump, and a device called a Riley Link. The monitor sends the person's blood sugar number to an app on their phone. Then the Riley Link allows the phone to send a radio signal to the pump to tell it how much insulin to give the person.
This is what allows them to talk.
That's
and
very sci-fi.
It's totally crazy.
Jonathan does still have to adjust his pump before meals or exercise, but he says his levels have never been more stable.
It has the effect of improving your blood sugar numbers and then also just easing your anxiety, which is actually kind of amazing.
Dr. Peter Sr. knows of 10 loopers, including two doctors. How does he feel about it?
I think, in general, a kind of sense of admiration and respect.
There is the danger of malfunction. Too much or too little insulin can lead to a coma, even death. But Dr. Sr. says type 1 diabetics are used to risk.
I don't know many other conditions where I give people the drug to treat it and say, make up your own mind about how to take it. And if you stop taking it, you could die. And if you take too much, you could die. And you have to live your life trying to balance on this tightrope.
Similar artificial pancreas technologies do exist, but they're expensive or years away from being approved for market. That's why the hashtag for the Looped Facebook support group is We are not waiting.
Things need to change at a government and legislative level that we haven't figured out yet.
The FDA issued a warning last year after one patient had a serious adverse event. Jonathan has had a few minor malfunctions, but after 2 years on cruise control, he says he'd never turn back.
Chat Weather, brought to you by Design Flooring Center, with you every step of the way. Chat Weather, powered by AccuWeather.
What a fantastic day it was in Medicine Hat on this Thursday. While I was in the radio studio with Sydney on 94.5 and with Kim on my 90, so oh my, just beautiful days. Just beautiful day outside today. It was wonderful, and hope you had a chance to get out there and enjoy it. Maybe go for a ski, take a walk. If you didn't, if you're just looking outside, we might have a better day tomorrow. But as Friday rolls into Saturday, we're going to roll into what's known as an 80% chance of snow. So that could come into the afternoon. Tonight, still only a 30% chance. But what a beautiful Thursday that we had. Got up to 2 degrees today when it's normally minus three. 1987's record. Safe, set, in the books, and not worried about. Zero out there under a partly cloudy sky. The sky should be fairly clear this evening with some clouds to deal with. But again, 30% chance of snow out there. The winds now from the northwest, they seem to be southerly winds during the day, northerly at night, and that is what's cooling us off tomorrow morning, a little bit chillier than what we saw today, but nowhere near the minus 20s. Right now, the zero feels like about minus 6 degrees, and once we share information with you from across the province, you're looking at zeros in Drumheller, Calgary, Bow Island, plus one in Lethbridge, 2 degrees in Edmonton, and Brooks with a few clouds is minus one, while Saskatchewan, they're dealing with some Arctic cold that we're just not seeing. Once again, that beautiful protective bubble that keeps us warmer than most of our friends east and west of us sometimes isn't protecting Saskatchewan at all today. So nobody left the door open. Minus 13 in Regina, minus 16 under a clear sky in Saskatoon. Lots of cloud in Leader and minus 9. Mix of almost clear and few clouds in Maple Creek. And it's very cloudy in Swift Current. So the radar will show you the clouds we were dealing with this afternoon. The sun managed to poke its head through there, which was nice to see some sun as the cloud starts to roll in more now. Edmonton also plenty of cloud today, and this whole system with lots of precipitation, as I can show you, pushing its way into the mountains. There you go. Now, once again tonight, we want to talk about travel. There's about 70 million people who'll be traveling into the areas that are affected by the low-pressure system that is going to pop up once again down here in Texas and move toward the eastern seaboard. This system is going to give snow to Toronto as well as Ottawa and Montreal before it moves off into Atlantic Canada. So if you have some traveling to do tomorrow or into the weekend, be wary of that. But if you're going to be in Brooks, know that you'll have sun throughout the day. Slight chance of snow, but as the day goes on, chance of snow 80% into the evening. Medicine Hat, -2 before a partly cloudy night. But again, there is the risk of snow this weekend. Stay right there. We'll go east to west next. Very cloudy in Atlantic Canada today and still tonight with a snowfall in St. John's. Halifax, icicles. Yeah, hasn't yet decided whether it's going to be snow or just rain. Charlottetown, -7. It's -2 in Halifax, -6 in Ottawa. Quebec City, -7. Both Ottawa and Quebec City will be affected by the low-pressure system that will be soon moving up the east coast into Atlantic Canada. And there's where it's the coldest in the country today. Thunder Bay and Winnipeg, Prince Albert, all minus teens with the wind chill in the mid-minus 20s. -11 in Moose Jaw, -8 in Fort McMurray with snow. Winnipeg, -17, Prince Albert, -19, and Thunder Bay, -12. Things warm up to a beautiful 1 degree in Grand Prairie. Kelowna, raining and -1. Vancouver, just cloudy and 3. And in Victoria, 6 under a cloudy sky tonight. A trio of Métis librarians have created a podcast that's meant to help other Indigenous people share their stories.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Misnagan Iskwayag. We are the Book Women.
The Book Women podcast encourages others to write, publish, and edit, and also provides resources on how to get started in storytelling. The group, who all graduated with master's degrees in library and information studies, say it was important for them to share their expertise to help others create art for and by Indigenous people.
We don't see ourselves within the process, and we don't see ourselves as content creators, and we don't, because we're not necessarily featured as such. There's not a lot of examples.
The podcast just wrapped its first season with plans to start on a second soon. If you feel like your teen is spending more time in a virtual world than in the real one, you are not alone. A new survey finds the majority of parents are concerned about the hours wasted gaming. Laurel Gregory reports.
They should have a casualty counter.
That would be so good.
For these teens, gaming is a passion, a way to socialize and unwind.
My favorite game, like, so far is Minecraft, because it's like an open world and you can build like anything.
They're mainly building and there can be combat.
Most of my friends do have Xbox, and that's how we tend to connect.
The time they devote to gaming is the equivalent of working a part-time job, and a recent poll shows other North American teens are playing just as much. The University of Michigan surveyed parents and found 54% say teens are gaming 3 or more hours a day, and 86% strongly agreed their teens spent too much time playing video games.
Different families will have different rules about a lot of different things, and there's no absolute right or wrong. The most important thing to think about is whether or not the amount of time interferes with other activities and causes problems.
Parents reported limiting gaming by encouraging other activities, setting time limits, providing incentives, and even hiding equipment.
They're not allowed to play them before school, and after school, all of their chores have to be done.
It's always better to be upfront. And like anything that parents want to limit their teens' activities, it's important for parents to give a rationale, not just to say, oh, these are ridiculous and you shouldn't do it, but in fact, to actually have real discussions with teens.
Dr. Freed says parents should watch for red flags in their teens' behavior or routine, like a loss of sleep, withdrawing from real-life friends, or falling behind in school. For these teens, gaming is just a part of life, not their whole life, and their aunt has a plan if that changes.
It just hit the power button. It is a phenomenal thing. Just turn it right off.
Laurel Gregory, Global News.
An easy suggestion. Just turn it right off. Yeah. So some gamers play enough that it equates to the hours of a part-time job. I know in my day, the original NES system, Super Mario, we would sometimes get caught up in the evening when the friends came over and we were playing, but it was never more than a few hours one night a week. It wasn't a part-time job, but it was fun.
I think of my youngest brother, Mac, 20. I hope he's watching right now. He's not watching. He's playing his video games.
What do you say?
Like a part-time job. That's a full-time job. 8 hours a day for him.
But you've been known to get caught up in Red Dead Redemption.
You see, there are some games that deserve the time.
Okay.
Deserve the hours on end.
Just like
Red
a beautiful,
Dead is one of those games.
A beautiful sports story deserves the time as well.
That's right. Yeah. Well, coming up after, the McCoy Colts are doing some pretty incredible things on the basketball court, but it's also their biggest enemy as well. Find out the details when we come back. Utter madness at the Scotiabank Arena last night. The Toronto Raptors overcame a double-digit deficit late against the Indiana Pacers, to win by a single point and set a new franchise record, making 12 straight victories, the longest in team history. Kyle Lowry and Serge Ibaka combining for 62 points. On top of its historic run, Toronto is now 37-14, its best ever record after 51 games. Well, the senior boys basketball team at McCoy High School is so good, they have to find new ways to challenge themselves. They are undefeated against their South Zone counterparts and often outscoring opponents by 70, 80 points. And the Colts are listed as an honorable mention in the 3A provincial rankings because of that. And however, that is likely to improve after dropping number 4 Wetaskiwin last weekend. The only issue with this is that no other team in the South Zone really measures up to their caliber, so it can be difficult to challenge themselves. They're taking a trip to Brooks tonight, which is likely to be another big blowout victory, but the result on the scoreboard is only half the battle.
We work on individual stuff and also team stuff, like pressuring the ball and keeping the ball out of the middle and everything like that. It's just kind of an extra goal that we have when we go against teams that we know we're going
to
beat.
We try to incorporate our offense into a game that, you know, it's kind of like a practice game, so we can try to work out our offense, see what's good, we see what's bad.
We just hope that we stay healthy and we keep improving, making small improvements along the way, and that we don't peak too early. I mean, we're just, you know, we're kind of having a light practice tonight. This point of the season can be a real grind because there's so many games and so little practices that we're just trying to, we're trying to find our stride.
Win and you're in. That is all the Canadian women's soccer team is focusing on ahead of tomorrow's Olympic qualifier match against Costa Rica. They're bringing an invaluable weapon with them as well, with Christine St. Clair building on her record-setting goals mark. And as John Sexsmith reports, the Queen of the North has a special connection to a couple of Albertans.
Sarah Mattiello is the facilities coordinator for the Edmonton Sport and Social Club.
We're a fun first league, so we're all about getting adults active, meeting new people, being outside, playing sports year-round.
Sarah's also a soccer nut. She played at a high level during her youth, and she's a Premier League player as an adult.
I tore my ACL last year, so I can't actually play soccer right now, so I have to get my touches in however I can.
And Sarah is a massive fan of national women's team captain Christine Sinclair.
She's the greatest of all time.
Sarah has followed Sinclair's illustrious career very closely.
I got to meet Christine Sinclair and she signed my cleats, which is really exciting.
And she was ecstatic when the 36-year-old striker scored her 185th international goal last week, a record.
Sinclair wide open. Is this it? It is! Sinclair has done it!
It's the record for men and women's soccer, so it's not like, oh, she's just the highest women's goal scorer. It's like, no, she's the highest goal scorer of anyone, male or female, of all time from any country.
David O'Neill is the referee development officer for Alberta Soccer. He first saw St. Clair in Edmonton at the 2002 FIFA Under-19 Women's World Championship.
The word that comes to mind is a machine, a goal-scoring machine.
Prolific production that kicked off almost two decades ago.
As soon as she got the ball, you knew something was going to happen on the field.
And Sinclair created a surge of local soccer registrations by the thousands.
3.5% from 2002 to 2003, and registrations continued to climb for many years after that. And it's our belief that the U19 Women's World Cup and Christine Sinclair had a lot to do with that.
Canada faces Costa Rica in a CONCACAF Olympic qualifier on Friday. A win, and the Canadians are in. So don't be surprised if Sinclair plays an important part.
Captain Canada, if you will. So many people look up to her and watch her as an example of class and leadership and what it looks like to be a hard worker.
John Sexsmith, Global Sports.
Incredible. Christine, huge congratulations. Yeah. I know we've been saying that for a lot, but it's great to see the impact that she's having on
Sunday. She's great. She's great. Great pack there. An update before we get to the 7-day forecast. Police in our city still on the hunt this hour for an armed man in the city's south end. He's believed to be a suspect in several robberies in the area. Described as between 20 and 30, wearing black shorts, leggings, a green shirt, and a dark-colored hoodie. Do not approach him if you see him. He is armed and dangerous. Please call 911 if you do see him. Now our 7-day forecast for you. There it is, lots of sunshine heading into the weekend. The possibility of some snow that should better represent itself tomorrow. And yeah, that's rain on Tuesday. Rain on Tuesday. There you go.
1 degree rain.
Yeah, that's fine. We'll take that.
Okay.
Hey, thanks for choosing chat tonight. See you tomorrow.
Have a good night.